Don't start buying the bad news that is being put out by the bad people in the media. Because the fact of the matter is, I don't know what Trump's done yet that I disagree with. Can anyone tell me, by the way, anything that Trump has done that is bad? I don't know. What is it? Can anyone tell me, what's he done? Let's analyze. Oh, let's see. He imposed a ban on people coming in from countries which are predominantly Muslim. Now, is that good or bad? Think about that one. Now, what else has he done that's so bad? Let's see. He started to deport the really bad illegal aliens who are on wanted lists for having committed multiple felonies. That would be good only to who? Anyone who wants a safer, cleaner nation. Who is it bad to? I don't know. Those who like drugs? Those who like rape in their community? Why is that a bad thing to deport people who are on wanted lists for having committed multiple felonies and not even citizens? Why is that a bad thing? So what has he done that's actually wrong? Listen, I'll be the first to criticize where criticism is due. I don't know what he's done yet that's bad. All we hear is that his poll numbers are down. So, again, I could open up to you and say, if you were given 30 seconds with the president, what would you advise him to do to get his poll numbers up? By the way, I want to thank each and every one of you who have gone to a bookstore or Amazon or Kindle to order my great bestseller, Trump's War, His Battle for America. No, I'm not willing to be beaten up again in order to have it go back to number one on the list. People think that that's the only reason it happened, and I really didn't get beaten up, by the way. I got knocked down, but I bounced right back up. You try it at my age. No, you try it at my age. All of those you think you're wise guys, you see if you can hit a hard pavement and come bouncing back up. See what happens to you when you're my age and you get knocked to the ground by a thug a foot taller than you and 20 years younger than you. See if you can bounce right back up, because that's what I did. No broken bones, thank you. No broken hips. No, here I am. Thanks to the meatballs, I am surviving. The Chinese food. I'm a little giddy. I get this way around these birthday days. I can't believe that I've gotten this far. So tomorrow, just remember, close, small party for friends and family. And I got the greatest news of my life today. I don't know if I even can say it. It probably means more to me than anything of all. My granddaughter, my lovely daughter, they live pretty far away from me, and I really don't see them too often. We just don't. We lead our own lives. I don't see them much. That's the way the American world is today, and I accept it. Didn't I read Cahil Gibran to you? That our children are not our own. We don't own them. We bring them into the world, but we don't control them. I don't see them much. My granddaughter will be 3.5 years old, almost 4 years old this September. She's going to be at my party. I just found out an hour ago. I cannot believe it. I'm going to hold that girl. I'm going to show her off. I'm going to walk around. I'm going to drink a lot of wine. And I'm going to have a great time, and I'm going to thank God for every breath I take and everything I have, and thank Him for everything He's given me. Because frankly, as I said to you earlier from the great rabbi of the Chabad people, he said, your birthday is the date when God decided that the world cannot exist without you. And when you think about the descendants of ourselves, if we're family people, and you look back, I've been in houses, by the way, where people have pictures of their whole family going back to the old days in Europe. You know, you look on a wall, you see the grandfather, then the grandmother, then some of them even have great-grandfathers, great-grandma pictures of them. It's pretty beautiful. People have good, stable, middle-class lives, usually have pictures of their whole, you know what I'm saying? I love that because it shows us that we're not alone. It shows us that we're not born unto ourselves. It shows us that we're part of something much bigger than ourselves. It shows us that family is the core of civilization. That's what it shows us. Do you get that? Well, that's what I think Donald Trump needs to emphasize a little bit more, by the way. He is actually a great family man. I want you to think about that. Oh, I know about the divorces. That's not a crime, is it? Is it a crime to get divorced in America? If so, half America would be in prison. No, it's not a crime to have been divorced. He has beautiful children. He has grandchildren. Isn't that beautiful? He's multi-religious family, Christian and Jewish. That's also a crime now. How could they have painted him as an anti-Semite when his son-in-law is an Orthodox Jew and his grandchildren are Jewish? And his daughter converted to Judaism. Only the sick people in the media can make him into an... They tried that one. Now, they've been trying that. He was an anti-Semite. They dropped that. It didn't work. Then they tried a few other things. It didn't work. Now they're trying the Russia game. It seems to be working. It's almost working. It might work. It could work. Let's keep up the big lie. Well, I have a little guess coming for you. Here's the guess. Mr. Flynn, General Flynn, he would probably burn them faster than he would burn Trump. He knows things about the dealings of Hillary Clinton and Russia. We all know about the uranium deal. We all know that she sold America's uranium rights out to Russia. We all know her old man Billy took a $500 million. What? How much did he get? Millions of dollars from Russia to give speeches right after the uranium deal. We don't know what the others on the committee might have done with regard to Russia. After all, it's a long time they're talking about. And what goes around comes around. And once you start investigating this one, you might investigate that one. And you don't know how the dominoes might fall, Schumer. After all, we don't know where Schumer got his latkes from. The latkes could have come from Latvia, for all we know. They could have come in from Latvia, for all we know, Schumer. So we don't know what kind of Russian money went into the Democrats' side either. I don't think that Flynn is going to do what the Democrats thought he was going to do. And I'll tell you another thing, looking at this from the outside. Flynn, if you look at him, is a lean, tough, hard machine. The man is a general. He's not a talker. He's not a talking head. He's a general. He's a combat veteran. He's as tough as nails. He's old school American military. Not one of the super freaks that Obama stuffed into the military to degrade the military. One of the super idiots who can't fire a gun or fly a plane or steer a ship. This is old school, hardcore, kick him in the butt, Americana. He's not going to take this from the left. He's just liable to blow the lid off what they've been doing, not only with Russia, but perhaps with China. Perhaps with countries you can't imagine, the money that's flowed into the hands of the Democrats. So don't be so sure that Flynn was going to flip. Flynn might have just flipped the wig when he came in there and shown you the dark side of the Hillary Clinton camp. So don't count on that one, because I don't think it's going to happen. This is the Savage Nation. Again, I'm asking you a loaded question today, which is, what would you advise the president to do to see his so-called popularity ratings go up and his negatives go down? Well, it's going to happen anyway. I personally think that the worst is behind him. I know you say, what, are you crazy? Oh, no, no, he's on the ropes. He's on the ropes. They got him. They got him. After all, I just read Chuck Todd, who they gave a beard and fake glasses to make him look intellectual. Upchuck Todd's calling him a lame duck president already. Well, I got news for you, Chucky. Don't count your chickens before they hatch. That's number one. And number two, I'll tell you something else, Upchuck Todd, a total lightweight of the lowest order. Where'd this person come from? How did NBC even create this man? He's like a cyborg. A cyborg, a garbage man from New York Sanitation Department would be smarter than Upchuck Todd. He's a lame duck president to Upchuck Todd. What, the bright boy in the back room told him to say that today? That's his latest news? Here's what's going to happen. There's going to be a military interaction somewhere along the way and very soon. Because North Korea is begging for it. North Korea is begging to have their fat butts kicked. And I'm telling you what's going to happen. It's going to happen so fast it'll be in the blink of an eye. And his popularity will go through the roof. And it won't be a fake war like the type you used to with the Clintons. It's not going to be bombing an aspirin factory. It's going to be big, and it's going to be fast, and it's going to be definitive. And it's going to teach America that we have America back again with a great American leader again. And then what are they going to do, invent something else again the next day? One day, they're going to come to understand that everyone can look right through them. It's not that the king has no clothes. It's that the press has no clothes. Today is Friday, March 31st, 2017, and we have a little bit of interesting breaking news. Donald Trump has just met with Condoleezza Rice of Bush fame. Wow. Wow, oh wow, oh wow. President Donald Trump held a meeting Friday with former Secretary of State Condoleezza Rice, tweeting out a picture of the two of them. I don't know, my friends. I'm not a big fan of Condoleezza Rice. I mean, she held a cabinet position under George W. Bush. That alone, to me, is a little worrisome. And in October of 2016, I will remind you and the president, Rice wrote on Facebook, enough, Donald Trump should not be president, he should withdraw. But in December, Condoleezza Rice offered praise for Trump's pick for Secretary of State Rex Tillerson, who was at the time ExxonMobil CEO. Rice called Tillerson an excellent choice. What this portends for the drift of the administration, especially coming days after he attacked the conservative movement, mainly the Freedom Caucus, is for you to guess. My friends, this is the Savage Nation. We're talking about what can Trump do to raise his popularity. One thing I would advise is stop attacking the Freedom Caucus and stop talking to liberals like Condoleezza Rice so publicly. The roots of this presidency lie not in Condoleezza Rice, but in the people themselves, we the deplorables. It is not that she is bad, but she is not us. It is not that she is not a patriotic American, she is. But she's not of the same, let us say, organizational set, mindset as we are. If you were to say to Condoleezza Rice, we stand for borders, language, and culture, what do you think her answer would be? The same as George Bush's were. Not exactly borders, language, and culture. Here's another thing I'd advise the president myself. How about talk radio, Mr. President? You've not given one interview to any talk show host since you become president. Think about that. And maybe I am mistaken. But President Trump goes on television all the time. He goes on a very, very low-rated television show called Fox and Friends. They're nice people. They don't have big numbers. They don't have a large audience. The average person doesn't get cable, doesn't watch them, doesn't care. But he never goes on shows like this or others like this. Has he been on any radio show that you know of? I don't know of it. Maybe I'm mistaken. He must go back to the same avenues he used during the campaign. He must speak to the people directly. Yes, he does a rally here and there, and I think it's more for him than for his larger audience, because these are not large audiences, even if they're 15,000 people, let's say. How big is 15,000 people when you compare it, let's say, with this radio show? This radio show, just in case you don't know, it has an AQH across the country. I don't know what it is, 350,000. That means about every quarter of an hour, 350,000 to 400,000 people are tuning into this show. Think about what I just said to you. That's a lot larger than any cable TV show. Talk radio has the largest audiences in the media. Do you know that or don't you know that? It's the most influential outlet in the media. Did you know that? How else do you explain that my book, Trump's War, without any appearances on Fox and Friends or Fox and Enemies or Fox and Midgets, how did I get here without any appearance on Fox News? I mean, I'm banned because of the leprechaun. I know that. That's my guess. The leprechaun is terrified that someone else might breathe and eat one day. How is it possible that Trump's War became number one without any television appearances, without any real major radio appearances? How is it possible? Because this audience is extremely large and is very loyal. I would guess that this is the most loyal radio audience in the entire business. How do I prove that to you? Well, I never mention it much, but I did win a contest to become nominated into the Radio Hall of Fame, the National Radio Hall of Fame. Oh, it's a huge deal. There's a Jazz Hall of Fame, there's a Baseball Hall of Fame, there's a Boxing Hall of Fame, and there's a Radio Hall of Fame. I was in a direct competition with a very skilled performer, a good man, Sean Hannity. He has a bigger show than I do. He's been on longer than I have with more stations. I beat him by a large majority. How is that possible? Because I have a more loyal audience than anyone in the United States of America, as proven by their electing me to the National Radio Hall of Fame and them buying Trump's War and making it number one on the New York Times list. So I go back to the main point. Donald Trump should stop meeting with liberals and attacking conservatives, and he should get back to talk radio as fast as possible. This is the Savage Nation.
And we're trying to save this young Trump administration, and I do think there is a crisis on many fronts. Is some of it of his own making? Art, XLM, you're on the air with the Drudge Report.
I wanted to tell Trump, don't give up. Keep it simple. And no matter how unpopular the...
Whoa, hold on. What does that mean, keep it simple?
Keep it simple?
Yeah, what is that? Specifically, that's not enough advice to save this situation. Keep it simple. Keep it simple.
Yeah. We have times as humans to overthink things. There's a lot of decisions. There's a lot of bills that are trying to be passed, but people end up getting things added on to them.
Well, but hold on. You don't think that Congress is deliberately sabotaging? Because I suspect there's a sabotage. Do you know Obama had the stimulus package on his desk before Inauguration Day? What did this Congress give this great man? Nothing.
Right.
So, all right. Well, okay, Art. We'll keep it simple. Thank you. Just keep it simple.
Well, I did. I brought you Chinese food.
Well,
what simpler is that?
It is Matt Drudge here celebrating this 75th anniversary. 75th anniversary of this man. It is an anniversary of sorts.
It is unbelievable, and I'm so honored that you're here. I turned my microphone over to him and my chair.
Well, now you're not going to get it back. Because this is the quality of calls you're getting?
Yes.
Keep it simple?
Yes.
I don't know how to save it?
No. How many years have you had the Drudge Report?
It's 22. I started in 95. And when did you start?
94.
Okay, so we're all kind of, you were birthed a little bit before me. I have not missed a day. You practically don't miss a day.
I take vacation days.
It's been a heck of a ride, you know, and it just feels like yesterday.
Blink of an eye.
Just feels like a blink of an eye. Now, how old were you when you started this show, Michael?
52.
52 years old. For everybody out there who is in a midlife.
And wants to give up.
In a midlife.
Right.
Look at what this man did with his 50s and 60s.
Well,
look at this.
I'll admit it.
Michael, do you realize you are at the top of your craft? Number one book in the country. A radio show, you roll down your windows and you hear you.
Wow.
I don't even have to tune you in. I just roll down the window.
Oh, what a compliment.
Think of that. I was coming in yesterday. You're the Bay Area, stuck in traffic in Barcadero. One person had you on. Another person had you on. Do you know what's happening here? People are nervous.
Mm.
It could go back to Hillary. You know, she looks like she's running again.
Oh, yeah. Same message.
Third time is the charm.
Same message. Same message.
So
global warming, women, war, peace, children, same message.
So all she needs is a million more this time?
Mm.
Are there a million more? Have there been a million more illegals that will come in who will sneak the vote?
I don't know.
Since the election, so I don't know either. Now, Melania is moving into the White House. Could this help to soften some of Trump's edges?
Will they care, though, Matt?
Nancy Reagan is billed as a secret behind Ronnie. That she soothed him. She played watchdog.
Please, this is a family show.
Okay.
Is that what they did with each other? She was the watchdog?
She was the watchdog. I do think having Melania there and the son there.
Yeah,
yeah, you're right. The Rosies.
They'll pick on the
son. Rachels. The Rachel. I dare you, Rachel Maddow. Go after the son. I dare you.
Go ahead, Matt. Give it to her.
I dare you, Rachel.
Give it to that sick
but you know.
Freak. Give it to that sick freak.
But hold on a second. I'm getting a little bit nervous about the media situation. Do you know the media was near death? The New York Times was holding on to the short hairs. Do you know Vanity Fair was going under? CNN barely had a fraction. Mm. Some of the networks had NAs. Do you know what an NA is in ratings?
No.
Not able to register.
Unbelievable.
Trump has saved the media.
By Trump.
Look, record ratings now.
Why?
Because the opposition is consolidating. They're following every bouncing ball. People actually believe Trump is a Russian agent.
Oh, God.
This is the drugged ones. This is the drugged ones. How do you get them off? Anyway, I don't mean to hog the airtime here.
No,
I'm not hogging.
You don't do radio. I love it.
Hold on a second here. Ken FTL down in Southern Florida, you're on the air with Drudge and Savage.
Savage, you're talking about what should Trump do? Do exactly what he's been doing. Run the country. It's been just over 60 days. And I'm getting a little tired of every time I listen to a station, including the conservative ones. Oh, he's in trouble. Oh, my God.
I like the passion, at least. That's a little more. Thank you. They should put him in.
Here's the question: should he get harder, Matt, or should he back off and be Mr. Softy? Go on, you're the media maven. Wait, you know the man sitting here in my broadcast chair is a personal friend of mine. We've known each other for a number of years. You don't know two people on earth who had more to do with Donald Trump getting elected.
I don't know that.
Well, okay, I'll take response. You don't have to say that. I'll take it. You know why I backed Donald? I didn't know him at all. His message was my message, borders, language, culture. He wanted a wall. He wanted to restore the faith in America. He wanted to restore our faith in the cultural basis of this country. So I figured let's go for it because the opposition here is against everything I believe in. But I saw that you were pretty consistently...
I come at it from a different side. I like Donald the man even before he ran. I think he is one of the most fascinating Americans that have ever lived in the modern era.
Hmm.
He is a throwback. You talked about an old school.
Yes.
An old school. He's old school. Part of me is his personality is not being totally used here.
Hmm.
The charm. The guy who ran the hotel. The guy who had a number one TV show with The Apprentice. And don't mock me, Rachel. Come on. This is part of charisma. charisma is needed in this job. This isn't just getting a bill through Congress. This is also charisma. So I wish they would let him return to Donald Trump, the full Donald Trump. So we're disagreeing already.
What about the tweeting every day?
I think he thinks that's fun.
What do you think?
Twitter to me, I don't do much of it because I don't think the audience is that large. I think it's the junkies that are, it's feeding the junkies. So to me, it's a broader thing. I would sit down and give an interview with Oprah. I would do it. I know. Okay, you're rolling your eyes. Here we go.
I didn't say no. I was surprised.
Do you know in the 80s he did? And she melted in his presence.
Yeah, I can see that.
The audience of women melted in his presence. Now, that doesn't mean he changes his policies. That doesn't mean less taxes, smaller government, seal the borders. I think he's going to lay the first brick, by the way. Watch. He's going to lay the brick. He's going to slab that cement on that brick and he's going to put it down. But why not do a little bit more to reach out to the other half? Now, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe that's the Condoleezza Rice.
You have been listening to the man who I affectionately call the Hearst of our time. And the thing about Matt Drudge, he doesn't want to hear it. He's just exactly a guy in my house. We just had Chinese food together. He honored me by coming out for my birthday to be with me because he's my friend, number one. But he's also, never underestimate this, the statement I'm going to make. Ordinary guy. You see him in the street. Average guy. But he's probably the most powerful media figure in the country. He doesn't want to hear this. So he says to me, Michael, do you realize your show is really that powerful? I see the same thing you see in me, I see in you. Why? Because we know our realities. Meaning, if you can walk with kings and never lose the common touch.
Well, I was in D.C. this week. I couldn't wait to get out of there. You know, nonstop sirens, nonstop bomb threats, a very strange feeling in the air. I grew up in D.C. It was never like that. A sense of something is not right. You know, the highest percentage of Hillary voters was where? Washington, D.C.
Really?
Trump is living in a place with the highest percentage of people who voted against him. It would have been as if Hillary went to Wyoming.
No, it'd be like Michael Savage broadcasting in San Francisco. Come on.
So maybe it can work.
It works.
Maybe it can work. All right, early days, Rasmussen, who I trust, who was literally the closest in the general election. People don't realize that. Rasmussen actually got it right. He is showing danger for Trump. I don't think that's fake. I think he is showing danger. I think attacking the Freedom Caucus was calculated to get something through the House. That still doesn't mean he can get it through the Senate. You've got McCain who's going to block. You've got Lindsey Graham who's going to block. So Donald Trump has been dealt a very bad hand here. Does the audience understand that? He has a bad hand. And that's just the way it is. Now, do you leave the casino altogether? Do you go to take a break? Does he take a break?
You told me you think he should disappear for a while.
Well, you know, Nixon wasn't in your face. Since when did the president become someone who was in your face daily? I wish he would just go to work. Behind the scenes. Just go away behind the scenes and go to work.
I mean, don't be so...
But I think with after Bill Clinton, you had to be in the public face every day. You had to be a part of the pop culture. Obama took it to new heights. Mm-hmm. The cover of People magazine every other week or out, you're out of favor. Mm. I don't think President Trump needs to be out front every day saying something. I think we would respect him if he got serious things done. And the end result, you judge the tree by the fruit.
You're listening to the Savage Nation, and we have a very important guest. He's just left the theater. He's done more than I ever thought he would do. He honored me by coming here, but he also is extremely private. And I implored him, after stuffing him with Chinese food, to please say a few words to the audience. And he's so good-natured that he just did it. But don't underestimate the influence of this man. Everybody in the world who is in the public eye reads the Drudge Report every day, as I do. We all know that. So you just heard his view of what must be done for the president to thrive. It's that simple. And what I'm going to ask you, the audience, is a similar question again. Is there anything going on outside of America that you think he needs to be doing? What should he be doing outside of our borders? Or the bigger question is, should he be focused only on domestic issues right now? Or do you want to see him doing international issues? What would you prioritize, crushing ISIS or building the wall? Me? Build the wall. Build the wall. ISIS is already on the run, thanks to the Russians, not thanks to Obama. Thanks to the Iraqi army and the Russians, ISIS is on the retreat right now, not thanks to Obama and Hillary Clinton to let them thrive. So the fact of the matter is, I think he needs to focus personally, Matt, and everyone else listening to the show, only on domestic. Build those factories in Western Pennsylvania. I've talked about it many times. Come back on talk radio. Do once a week this show, other shows. Talk to your people. Talk to the Eddies. Talk to the Ediths. And, of course, internationally, North Korea must be stopped. General Mattis has said that. That's the headline in the Drudge Report. I've been saying it for weeks now. This is no joke anymore. North Korea is threatening to nuke us. And the psychotics in the media, the nutcases, the front men, the upchuck tods, what they're talking about is Russia, not North Korea. It just shows you that William Blake, the poet, was right when he said, the eye that alters, alters all. Well, my eye is not altered. It's focused. It's been a miraculous day for me that Matt Drudge came in to be with me. He said he would, and he was true to his word. I did not expect him to go on the air because he's notoriously reclusive. He guards his privacy more so than the president does. But I guess the Chinese food warmed him up a bit. If you were to think about what Matt Drudge said on this show, did you think he said anything unique? I do. I'd like to talk about that in the next hour because he made some statements that I think are worth talking about. He is the Hearst of our time. Never underestimate the power of radio or the power of the Internet. This is the Savage Nation. Ron on WABC, Line 8. Go ahead, please. What's on your mind?
When will Matt Drudge and Michael Savage start a newspaper to take on the New York Times?
We just did. It's an electronic newspaper called Radio. Why would he need a newspaper when he has a website that is read by more people than all the newspapers you could imagine?
There will always be people that just get the news from the newspaper.
Yes, that is true. The kind in San Francisco, the old types, they sit in the cafes and they run their finger down the paper, and every line they read, like they used to read the Bible, like their grandfather read the Bible chapter and verse. Whatever the idiots write, they believe. You know what? I'm not going to open a newspaper, Ron, but I'm going to send you something with newsprint in it, made of paper and ink. It's called Trump's War. I like to call it Savage's War, but it's Trump's War. Stay in the line. That goes out to you. You're going to get one of the first editions, first printing. By the way, the book is probably in its third printing by now, and I don't know if you can still get a first edition, first printing. Maybe, maybe not. This is the Savage Nation. I'll be here for one more full hour. The number one question today has been this. What can Trump do to raise his popularity and save our revolution? Notice I say our revolution. It is not his revolution. He was our spokesman. And I would like to put it in another context. I live in California where I have no representation. I have no congressman. I have no senator. Nobody. Zero. I live in a different land altogether. Donald Trump is my supra representative of the things I believe in. I want cleaner streets. I want safer streets. I want criminal aliens deported. I want a wall built with Mexico, etc. I'll be right back to talk about this and more right here on the Savage Nation.
Good evening, Mr. and Mrs. North and South America. All the ships and clippers at sea. Let's go to France. France, London. The terms of surrender for the Italian army in Ethiopia have just...
Now you're talking. Now that's radio. Now that's radio. That's radio.
About 38,000 prisoners.
That's radio.
Bringing the number of Italian captives in Ethiopia.
That is Walter Winchell, one of the greats. I'm proud to tell you that he is in the National Radio Hall of Fame, as am I, Michael Savage. I know you don't read about this in the San Francisco area, but they live in their own world where only the putrid and the sick are put on the high pedestals of Nowhereville. In the last hour, we had a surprise guest, as many of you may have heard. We had Matt Drudge on, a man who is notoriously protective of his privacy. And I thought it was a very interesting appearance, not so much because he agreed to do so, but because he said certain things about Trump's presidency that I think are worth repeating. We were talking for a couple of hours on this show about what we can do, what we could do to advise the president to increase his popularity. And there were some good ideas. I had some. The callers had some. But Mr. Drudge had some as well. I'd like to hear what you have to what you think about these things on the show today. Today, again, is my one and only birthday. It gets once a year. And as the holy man said, your birthday is the date when God decided that the world cannot exist without you. That's very beautiful. He also said, because time itself is like a spiral, something special happens on your birthday each year. The same energy that God invested in you at birth is present once again. Well, I would say that that special energy just appeared on the show. This is not a guest-driven program, as you well know. It's a single-man-driven program. And what do you think about it? You're on the radio.
Yes. Well, happy birthday. And fan. And
get out the noose.
Matt Drudge absolutely broke the mold.
What mold?
For the media.
And oh, you mean, wait, hold on. You mean when he appeared on the scene?
Well, he gave a speech at the National Press Club in D.C. Just demolished them.
When?
President Trump has walked in those same footsteps. Well,
let me ask you, did you go on his website in the morning? You generally go on his website, Drudge Report?
Oh, 10 times a day.
You don't? Oh, you do, 10 times a day.
Yeah.
Well, you know what? I'm actually preventing him from refreshing his page. No, he's got people to do it for him. He's retired many years now. Oh, come on, no, I'm just joking. He's in charge of himself. He is so hands-on, it's not funny. All right, let's go across the country to KSFO. Drew on line 8. What is your comment or question today on the Savage Nation program?
Thank you for having me on. I just wanted to say that you and Matt Drudge are a fantastic duo, and you guys should team up more often and more, you know, strong conservative allies like yourselves.
I know, but I can't afford them. He costs too much.
I know, God.
Drew, I'm kidding. No, did you enjoy the synergy of the two men? Did you like the synergy of Savage and Drudge?
Absolutely. You know, we're all just these little beams of light, and we shine brighter together. So,
wow.
You know, I really thought
that beautiful? That's nice. You know, that is the whole point of group cohesion. And it is something that is sorely lacking on the conservative side. There's almost no cohesion whatsoever. One thing you got to say about the vermin on the left, they're all on the same message. They never attack each other. And they consistently push the same exact themes and message without variance whatsoever. So, yes, there needs to be more coming together of those of us on the right side of things. I don't know who the cheerleader is to do that. It would be nice if people could come to understand that we're fighting for our survival, both individually and collectively. But I don't know how that's ever going to happen. Thank you. I'm sending you a copy of Trump's War, and hope you enjoy reading it from cover to cover. Let's go again to KSFO, my hometown of San Francisco, where more people than you can imagine in this liberal bastion tune into this show. I hear it from I know some people who are old-line Democrats in the city. I didn't say progressives. I wouldn't even call them liberals. They're old-time Democrats because that's their political affiliation. They all listen to this program. Not every day, not 3 hours a day, but they all tune in. Now, why would they tune in? They're so bored of hearing each other tell each other the same crap that maybe they want to hear somebody from the other side who they respect, who can support his arguments, present his arguments once in a while, so they don't live in the same bubble of Pacific Heights and the San Francisco newspapers, which don't exist. So I'm the only outlet that they have. Think about it. They're living in the prison of their own dialect. They're living in the prison of their own one-party system. They're living in the prison of their own propaganda. So maybe they want to step outside, and it's a safe place to go. That's why this show is skyrocketing, not only in San Francisco, but everywhere else. Sam on KSFO, line 4, what's on your mind?
Hey, Dr. Savage, thank you for the call. Just hearing your interview with Matt Drudge, it was like Leonardo da Vinci meeting Albert Einstein. It was one of the best interviews I think you've done this year.
Well, who was Da Vinci and who was Einstein?
Two of the greatest minds.
No, but who was Da Vinci and who was Einstein? That's the question.
Great inventors.
No. Which one of us was the Da Vinci and which one of us was the Einstein?
Oh, you were Da Vinci and he was Einstein.
Is that an insult, Matt? That's very sweet. I'll take your analogy to heart. That's beautiful. Great birthday gift. Sending you a copy of Trump's War so you don't have to go buy one. You know what would happen if every listener of this show who actually loves this show and supports it went out and bought a book this weekend? Yeah, I'm peddling books. Yes, I'm selling books. Because if not me, who will? Fox News? Bill O'Reilly's going to do it? Fox and Friends is going to suddenly say this is a great book, we need him because he respects our values? No. I'm the only one who can do it, so I hope you understand what I'm saying to you. I do need your support, because without listeners like you, there would be no Savage Nation.